I'd like to call the meeting to order. Hector, would you lead us in the pledge?
Certainly. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Hector. Adoption of agenda, any changes?
No changes.
Move to adopt the agenda as presented.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Item two, study session, individual school presentations focused on academic progress and strategic planning. Steve?
Okay, we will start this evening with A.J. Mitchell and just go right down the agenda. What we did at the last meeting, we had asked individuals if they could hold their questions towards the end. I think it was good practice, and I think it made the meeting go a lot faster.
Good evening, Board President, Board Members, and Superintendent Zimmerman. I am Molly Algaraz, and I am the principal of A.J. Mitchell Elementary. I'd like to start by recognizing the achievement gains at A.J. Mitchell. In 2011, A.J. Mitchell was labeled a C school and entered into a school improvement warning year. Last year, we raised our achievement label to a B. This should be considered a tremendous accomplishment considering all the ambiguity and changes that occurred last year. It's evidence of the dedication and hard work that our Mitchell teachers, students, and families put forth on a daily basis. To earn the B, we had a composite score of 64, which included the 61% passing and the 3 points for ELL reclassification. We earned 59 growth points plus the one bonus point. We tested 99% of our students. In total, we earned 124 points. We are 16 points away from being an A school. We want to continue to experience such academic success. So in this presentation, I'm going to review our 2012 AIMS data, our plan for academic achievement, and I will share some of the success that we've already had at A.J. Mitchell. In 2012, 63% of our third graders passed in reading and 54% passed in math. At the fourth grade level, 62% passed in reading and 49% passed in math. At the fifth grade level in 2012, 78% passed in reading, 55% passed in writing, and 49% passed in math. As you can see, from the last three slides, our data over the last 5 years, the trends have been inconsistent. You can also see that our achievement goals last year were not met. I've listed the goals here that were set by Mr. Young last year. Based on the goal set, it's evident that the approach in setting last year's goals were simply to match or surpass the state's AMOs. However, there is somewhat of a flaw in this strategy. To meet the current AMOs, A.J. Mitchell would have to demonstrate up to a 35% increase. So to derive our achievement goals, we used the same formula that the state did and took a similar incremental approach. I'll take a minute to read the state's formulaic explanation. It states, to derive the annual targets, Arizona calculated the difference between the average statewide proficiency on AIMS and 100% in 2020. That difference was divided into equal annual increments to reach 100% proficiency in 2020. These AMOs were set for each grade separately for mathematics and reading. So for our second grade, we used last year's data and based the 2013 goals on the 2012 data set. However, for our current fourth and fifth graders, we set goals that were based on the cohort. For example, we looked at how last year's fourth grade students performed and calculated the fifth grade goal using the state's formula. When those percentage increases were less than 5%, which is the board's goal, we increased the percentage to 5%. These are our third grade goals. Since there's not AIMS data for this cohort, our goal is based on how last year's cohort performed. And again, for our fourth and fifth graders, you'll see in the subsequent slides that those are based on cohort data. But for these third graders, last year our third graders, 63% of them passed. So our goal is 68% of third grade students passing in reading. That's a 5% increase in academic achievement and aligns with the board's goals. In 2012, 54% of our third graders passed in AIMS. So our goal for 2013 is for 60% of our students to pass in math, and that percentage increase aligns with the state's formula for achieving proficiency and would be a 6% increase from last year's scores. To set our achievement goals for fourth grade, we looked at how the cohort performed last year and set our goals accordingly. Last year, 63% of third graders passed reading AIMS. Our goal is for 68% to pass this year. That would be a 5% increase and aligns with the board goals. Last year, 54% of our third graders passed math AIMS. Our goal is for 60% to pass this year. That would be a 6% increase and aligns with the state's formula for achieving proficiency. To set our achievement goals for fifth grade, we looked at how the cohort performed in reading and math last year and set our goals accordingly. There is no writing goal for the cohort since they do not take the AIMS writing in fourth grade, so our writing goal is based on how last year's fifth grade students performed. When these students were in the fourth grade, 62% of them passed in reading. Our goal is for 67 to pass this year. That would be a 5% increase. Last year, 55% of our students passed in writing. Our goal is for 61% to pass this year. This is a 6% increase and aligns with the state's formula for achieving proficiency. In math, 49% of our fourth graders passed math AIMS. Our goal is for 56% of our fifth graders to pass in math AIMS, and that percentage aligns with the state's formula for achieving proficiency and would be a 7% increase from last year's goal. Although the goal is somewhat low, it's our loftiest percentage increase. And I'd like to also note that our fifth grade cohort is one of our lowest achieving cohorts, especially in the area of math. This grade level will need to demonstrate the highest percentage increases. However, when they achieve these accomplishments, our AMOs will align more closely with the state expectations in just a few years. So now that I've reviewed our achievement data and set percentage increase goals, I'm going to review some of the new strategies and steps we will have taken to achieve our goals. First, we're focusing on instruction. In order to accomplish this, we've implemented a daily common plan time, made sure that plan time was equitable and standardized. We have weekly grade level meetings. We also have regular professional development. Across the district professional development, which we implemented in writing last month. And at our site, we have data meetings every month in which we examine and analyze progress monitoring achievement data, so that we can create fluid intervention groups, refine our instruction, assess our growth, and set intermittent goals. Our curricular focus has also been on the implementation of CCSS, the Common Core State Standards. All of our grade levels create common lesson plans, and we're working towards creating and implementing common assessments in math and towards standardizing our grading practices in writing. In terms of our instructional minutes, we were able to shorten our lunch block. We did not shorten how much lunch or lunch recess time the students have, but we did decrease the transition time between the grade level lunches. And this schedule change allowed our intervention teachers and our instructional aides to have more instructional interaction with our students. We also decreased whole class breaks and decreased the number of classroom parties so we could spend the time in school on content instruction. We've also taken a deliberate step in targeting students for intervention and extension in the areas of reading and math. For daily intervention, we target first through fifth grade falling far below and approaching students in our pullout reading program. We target all K-5 students in our leveled instruction across the grade level, and all teachers provide daily classroom interventions. For extensions, we target fourth and fifth grade exceeding students in our pullout reading program. All teachers also create and implement daily extension activities in the classroom. At the kindergarten level, we have both interventions and extensions on a daily basis for all kindergarten students in the pullout program and across the grade level for targeted instruction. In tutoring, which we have three times a week, we target K through fifth grade students who are most intensive, are falling far below students who are in that bottom 25%. We also track our attendance in our tutoring program to ensure that these students are indeed receiving the necessary support. In our intervention and extension programs, we've standardized our curriculum materials to ensure that all students have access to the same academic program. I also want to mention here that we have a monthly student spotlight where teachers at each grade level select a student to be recognized for academic gains, and those are personal gains for those students. As part of our achievement plan, we've also focused on developing partnerships with parents. We've increased our general communication through weekly principal newsletters, monthly study skill parent involvement or homework newsletters, and teachers write monthly positive notes home. We've also focused on keeping parents more informed about academics. Every 4 weeks, teachers contact parents of students who have a D or an F. At PTO meetings, we give an academic achievement update for every meeting. We have data boards, which I put a picture up there at the front of our school that displays grade level data. Each teacher also displays student work and classroom achievement data in the bulletin boards outside of their room. This has enabled us to be transparent about our progress and cultivate a school culture that's focused on academic achievement. We've used different strategies to get parents more involved in school activities. We now have evening PTO meetings where we provide student supervision so that parents can attend the meetings and they don't have to find a babysitter. We've dispersed more information on how parents can volunteer at our school, and we have a monthly volunteer spotlight where we recognize a school volunteer. We also had math and reading night, which we had last month, and we used some of our Title I funds to create an addenda in which a teacher acts as a parent liaison so that we can reach out and inform parents who may not have been involved in our school. Of course, focusing on teachers and staff is an essential piece of our achievement plan. We've started a building planning committee so that we can make collaborative decisions regarding scheduling and calendar. In addition to the professional development that I mentioned in the earlier slide, we've implemented a teacher collaboration committee in which teachers can bring issues to another team of teachers and brainstorm strategies to support students. And together, as a team, we track strategy outcomes. Similar to our student spotlight, we also have a staff or teacher spotlight that's based on peer nomination or achievement data or a combination of the two. We have weekly staff meetings to increase communication and reiterate our focus on student achievement. Returning teachers and staff members also have professional goals they are working toward, and these goals are based on their performance evaluation from last year. On a side note, a few of our teachers are on improvement plans, and one teacher is not highly qualified. These teachers are being supported in a variety of ways, such as mentoring, coaching, and more personalized professional development. I also want to add that 9 of our 23 certified staff members are new to Mitchell. So I will be doing their evaluation early this year so they can understand my professional expectations and have specific professional goals to work towards. As I said earlier, at Mitchell, we've seen a tremendous amount of success in the past few months. So in addition to articulating our achievement data and our plan, it's equally important for me to share what we already have to celebrate. We've earned several awards. AJ Mitchell staff was awarded the NUSD Staff Spirit Award at the Back to School Rally. At the Santa Cruz County Fair, our students won a huge trophy for Best in Show for their tree ring paintings. We came home with 37 first place winner ribbons, 20 second place ribbons, and 5 third place ribbons. And as Dr. Varona pointed out in our September meeting, Mr. David Thompson, our reading interventionist teacher, was awarded the Santa Cruz County Teacher of the Year Award. We've also been fortunate enough to have several facility improvements. We've planted bushes and flowers in the front of our school where there once was empty planters. The exterior of our building was painted. The siding was replaced on the former Coronado Ring. Our large sycamore trees were pruned so that our roof could remain in good condition. And we're looking into replacing the blinds in our classrooms. We're also starting several school clubs, including student council and sports, and we've made several community partnerships that will surely benefit our students and families. We'll be starting a Kiwanis Kids Leadership Club this year and partnering with the Kiwanis to recognize student achievement. The recent grand opening of the Nogales Family Resource Center at AJ Mitchell will support us in gearing up young children for kindergarten and will be a beneficial resource to all of our AJ Mitchell families. That concludes my presentation, but before we move on to questions, I want to take a moment to recognize the AJ Mitchell staff members who are here. And I'm really proud to have everyone here, so I just want to take a couple minutes and say them by name, because it means a lot to me that they're here supporting me and the students at AJ Mitchell. So first is Mr. David Thompson, our reading interventionist teacher, and as I said, Santa Cruz County Teacher of the Year. And then I'll go quick so that you guys don't have to clap after everyone. Okay, we have Daniela Salazar, who teaches kindergarten, Edith Sarmiento, who teaches third grade, Miss Cervantes, who teaches second grade, Miss McClure, who teaches second grade, Miss Patty Leon, who is my right hand and my administrative assistant, Miss Greenberg, who is our resource teacher, Ms. Sini teaches second grade. Ms. Rojas teaches fifth grade. Mr. Teachea teaches fifth grade. Mr. Fonserrada teaches kindergarten. Ms. Barojas is hiding in the back, and she teaches fourth grade. Ms. Villa teaches fourth grade also. Ms. Campista teaches kindergarten. Ms. Needy teaches music. And then I also want to recognize we have two parents who attended. Lourdes Ramos is a parent at AJ Mitchell, and Ida Sema Janik is also a parent. So I really appreciate all of your support. It means a lot to our families and to me, of course. And as I wrap up, I'd like to take this opportunity to invite you to AJ Mitchell. I know that you're all very busy, but we would love to have you come to our school and see us in action. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Hector?
Oh, just a comment more than a question. Thank you so much for taking the bull by the horns at AJ Mitchell. You're obviously, in my view, doing the right things, attainable goals, not pretend goals. The intervention programs are extremely important, and the assessments that you speak of, all the things that success are made from, and I'm very proud to see all of your staff here. That's wonderful. That shows the beginning that you've brought back to this place, and I congratulate you, and thank you guys for all you do and bringing this school back to where it needs to go. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yes, in your achievement plan, how is it that you're going to improve instruction more than what you just mentioned?
I'm sorry, how is it that I'm going to improve instruction?
Yeah, how will you improve instruction?
In a couple different ways. We have professional development that either I do. We also are being trained by West Ed that Angel and Ms. Zuniga have talked about. So that will help us make those improvements. I also am very visible in the school doing walkthroughs. That was another reason why we decreased our lunch, the amount of time that we have for our lunch block, because what I was finding is that I was either dealing with discipline for many hours or out on the playground or something like that, and so decreasing that time allows me to have more time in the classrooms. So those are just a few of the additional things that I didn't mention that we're implementing to help improve our instruction.
Thank you. Very good.
Mercy. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Superintendent Zimmerman, Dr. Alcaraz, thank you for highlighting the county fair with the special education students. That project was tremendous, and it was well done, and I thought it was a beautiful piece of art that should be showcased right in the back here of the board. Your emphasis on academic achievement is a keen focus, especially with your uninterrupted instructional time. Research is tenfold. You don't interrupt instruction. You let the teachers focus on their time in the classroom, and you're going to get results from that. Also, your instructional emphasis on the bottom 25%. To get those who fall within that range, that growth component is very important. When you break it down from the composite to the growth, I think your emphasis right there, especially considering the demographics of your school, is crucial. And finally, your parental involvement and your culture that you're trying to establish as a new instructional leader there on academics is going to go twofold for you. And I just want you to know that I think that you're off to a great start. Your staff here from last year going through 5 educational leaders on your campus, going from a C to a B, is, to tell you the truth, unprecedented where you are right now. And a lot is to do with what you did as a staff to keep the school together and have that keen, complementary, keen focus on academic achievement. And Mr. Thompson, you as being one of those leaders, being a teacher and being a teacher of the year, and also observing you at your most important duty a couple of days ago as a crossing guard is extremely notable. And I want you to know that the community has noticed all that you've done. Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Dr. Alcaraz, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Board President, Board Members, Mr. Zimmerman, and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dinina Vasquez. I'm the principal at Challenger Elementary. So I am here to show you what a wonderful school I have. Okay. At the beginning of the year, we got a letter from State Superintendent Hoopenthal, and we were a Title I high-performing, high-progress reward school. To be high-performing, you have to have an A letter grade, you have to have met the AMOs, and your bottom quartile students had to have above-average achievement and growth. Now, our bottom quartile students were in the 64.5 percentile in growth, which is really good. Now, we also had to have high progress. Those requirements were an A letter grade, above average growth for all students, and all students were at almost 61%, and the bottom quartile students with above average achievement. So we had really a small gap between our lower students, the bottom quartile, and all of the students. Now, since I made this presentation, I wasn't able to, I gave you a copy of the points. I didn't even bring this here with me. You have a copy there of the chart that shows the points that you need to get an A or whatever letter you get. Now, I compared 2011 to 2012. In 2011, our composite points, we had 79. 2012, we had 81. Our growth points in 2011 were 52% in the 52nd percentile. In 2012, we were in the 64th. Our ELL bonus, we got 3 points. You had to have reclassified 30% of your students, of your ELL students, to get the 3 points. Last year, we reclassified 47%. Our total points in 2011 were 131. In 2012, we had 146. So our grade in 2011 was a B, and 2012 was an A. Now, these were our goals for last year. Our goal was that 76% of all third, fourth, and fifth grade students would meet or exceed the math standards on 2012 AIMS assessment. Well, we didn't meet that goal. We had third grade, we had 77% pass, fourth grade 75%, those were the goals that we had, 77% for third grade, 75 for fourth, and 72 for fifth. Well, we didn't make it. We had 70% in third grade, 74% in fourth, and 78% in fifth, which was an average of 74. So we didn't make it by 2%. These are our strategic goals for this year. We have our goals from our scores from last year. Third grade in reading, 80% passed. The AMO is 82% passing for 2013. So we set the strategic goal at 83%. Our fourth grade, we had 83% pass reading. The AMO is 81% for 2013. And so we set our goal at 86%. Fifth grade, we had 84% passing. The AMO is 84 for this year. And so we set our goal at 87%. Now in math, we had third grade 70% pass, the AMO is 72%, so the strategic goal is 73%. And this 70% that I have here, this is what was given to us when we got our charts with our scores, but the state doesn't have us at 70% passing in math, because what they do is they look at the students that have been at that same school within the first 10 days of school until the very end, until they take AIMS. And according to the state, those students were at 72%. Now, fourth grade, they had 74% pass. The AMO is 70%. And so we set the strategic goal at 77%. Fifth grade, we had 78% pass math. The goal, the AMO is 68%. So we set our goal at 81%. Now in writing, we had 62% pass, and since there is no AMO, we set that a little higher at 70% for fifth grade. And these are just the AMOs for the last 5 years and the scores that our students have. This is third grade, and the AMO was 63% in 2008, and it stayed the same until 2011. So our scores in third grade, we've been going back and forth, 80, 83, 80, 83, 80. And in math, as you can see, we went down in 2010, and that's when they changed the test. And since then, third grade is pretty much plateaued. We went up to 71, we went down to 70. And fourth grade right now is working on that. They are working on this group of students and how we can raise their scores. And here is a graph that has those scores. Fourth grade started in 2008 at 77%. We went up in 2009 to 87. They did very well, but they changed. They went down. In 2009, 2010, all three grade levels went down. We went down to 273, and then they have been moving up steadily. In 2012, they scored 83% passing. Math, we had the same thing. They went up in 2009 to 89%. Then we had that big drop to 67, and then have continued to go up. And there is the graph. Now, fifth grade, they didn't drop in 2010. They have continued to improve every year. In reading, we started in 2008 with a 61% passing. By 2012, we have 84% passing. And in math, we started with 63% passing, and we've gone up to 78% passing. And there is that graph. This is something I wanted to talk about, is the gap between mainstream students and our ELL students. In 2011, in reading, and this is all third, fourth, and fifth together, in reading we had a 47% gap between the ELL students and mainstream. In math we had a 49% gap, and in writing we had a 60% gap. Now in 2012, the reading gap went down 39%. The math gap went all the way down to 10%, and our writing gap down to 27%. So we are closing that gap between our ELL students and mainstream students. So what are we doing? What are our strategies? We have data-driven decision-making, always. Formative and summative assessment data used for instructional decisions. We don't make any decisions without looking at the data. We use a Galileo benchmark and quizzes that the teachers, the grade levels, have made up for their classes. We use DIBELS. We use a writing scoring, the writing, the scores in their writing, and the ongoing classroom assessments, the theme tests in the core series. We have weekly grade level meetings to analyze data. Classroom strategies, we continued with the TQI in that we assess our students to see what it is we need to teach them. Then we instruct them. We assess again, and it doesn't have to be an actual test, but the teacher gives her lesson and she can tell who is not getting, who didn't understand. Then you remediate, you bring those kids out, and you work with that small group, the flexible groups, to give them an additional chance to learn. Then we assess again. We go from the whole group to the small group to the individual one-to-one. Our standards are posted and referenced on a daily basis. In the beginning of the day, the students know what they're going to work on that day. They have everything that they're going to do, all the standards that we call them now. Before they were objectives, we have them up on the board, and the teachers will say, this is what we're going to do today, and then they finish a lesson, they go back up, okay, we did this, now we're going to do this. So that the students always know what is going to be going on in that classroom and what they need to do. We're implementing Common Core standards, And with math, we're using, there's more use of manipulatives and modeling. There has to be modeling. The students can't learn just with pencil and paper. You've got to bring out all your manipulatives. The students have to actually use these manipulatives to understand what they're learning. And we applied for the White Elephant grant. Hopefully we'll get it, because we want to get document cameras for all of our classrooms, so that the teachers can, it'll be more hands-on. The teachers can actually work the manipulatives right there, and it'll be projected, and the students can be part of it. Classroom strategies, we have daily writing using the three types. Before every quarter, the teachers would focus on one genre of writing. Well, now we have the three text types, and they use those every day. They write every day using the different types. We integrate writing with the reading lessons, which is something that wasn't done as much before. If they read a story or anything, the students have to write about, you know, they have to answer questions, but they have to go into the passage and find details to support what they're writing. We have targeted grammar instruction, grade level team planning. We make sure that every grade level has their specials at the same time, so that the teams can get together and plan. We have software programs, Success Maker for K through 5, Achieve 3000, 2nd through 5th grade. We have Study Island, that was new last year, from 3rd to 5th grade, and Education City, that's K-2. Now, we have principal walkthroughs. I go into the classrooms, I'm checking to make sure that I see differentiated instruction, that the kids are focused, that there's student engagement. I have weekly grade level meetings with the teachers, and we discuss data or just what students are having problems, what can we do with these students, what materials are we using. Staff development, we've already had district-wide staff development in writing, but I want to have more with my teachers on differentiated instruction, student engagement, text-dependent questions, how to write text-dependent questions. And we have a lot of teachers with a lot of knowledge in the district, and I use my teachers for staff development, because they know a lot about student engagement. We've got teachers who are experts in working with ELL students, and I use them for staff development. We have grade level meetings for parents of at-risk students, and we are having those this month. So when we have assessed the students and we see that there are some students that are at risk of not succeeding, we pull those parents in, we meet with them, and the teachers talk to them, give them ideas what to do to help their students at home. Interventions. We have targeted 45-minute interventions in reading and math. We used to have interventions 5 days a week, but we have changed it, and we are having 4 days a week, 2 days of math and 2 days of reading, because we have to have 1 day to progress monitor the students, and that's when we can do it. Students that are intensive need to be progress monitored every week. Those that are strategic need to be progress monitored every other week. And benchmark students have to be progress monitored at least once a month. And we want to have time to do that. Now, for our interventions, we have teams of six or more teachers for each grade level. And benchmark students receive enrichment in math and reading. And now with expository reading being so important, for some of the benchmark students, we're using the science books. The science series is set up, it's Harcourt, and it's set up just like the reading series, so they're using that also for interventions. We have a variety of materials for practice and test prep, But the one thing we do is we monitor and adjust. We have our groups, but as soon as we assess students, we regroup. We regroup the kids according to their needs, and if students are in a very small group and they have caught up to the others, then we regroup them, bring down others who may have have other deficiencies. We have after-school tutoring 3 times a week, where we work on math, on reading, and English language development. Our K-2 interventions, we continue with the Reading First strategies and procedures. I still say that Reading First is the best thing that could have happened to Challenger Elementary. Now we have interventions, 1 day of math and 3 days of reading, 1 day of progress monitoring. And things that we focus on in math is we're working with the Common Core standards. We focus on number sense. We use touch math. They use the daily meeting board or calendar. Skip counting, we're still working with skip counting, and the use of manipulatives and modeling. Newcomer interventions, we test with the Spanish Dibbles because we need to see if they have reading skills in their language. And if they do, it's a very easy transition once the students pick up the language, the vocabulary. If they have very low Spanish reading skills also, then we know it's very tough. And we have to work a lot harder with them. Daily 45-minute language development, where we're working with the revised SEI standards, focusing on phonics and vocabulary. We now have the portable laptop center with DynEd, which the students will use. And we double dip our newcomers. And not only our newcomers, sometimes we double dip our very low students. And what we do is they go to the intervention at their grade level, and then we put them in the intervention in the grade level right before, because we feel that they have some skills that we need to work with still. And then we have the after-school tutoring 3 times a week, which is all English language development. Now, teachers work very hard at Challenger, and we've done well, but we also have a culture in our school. And that's another thing I want to talk about. We have clubs. We have a homework club Monday through Thursday where any grade level student can go in and work on their homework. We have Stuco. We have a color guard, which I'm very proud of. At the end of fourth grade teachers nominate certain students that they feel have a great attitude. They're hard workers, good citizens, and they're part of the color guard. We have a cheer team that we're proud of. They work really hard. And all of these, like the cheer club, we don't start cheer until after tutoring is over. So that doesn't start until 3:45. We have a computer club on Thursdays and a chorus that works during lunch. And it's an excellent chorus. They go and they sing at the hospital. They sing to, they've gone to Phoenix, and they've sung at the Capitol. They get together with Welty and Lincoln's chorus, and they have wonderful, wonderful performances. You've been there, Dr. Varona. And these are our celebrations. We love our celebrations. We have an end-of-quarter sing-out. At the end of every quarter, every student, teacher, everyone, all staff members, we sit outside at the amphitheater, and we celebrate the end of the quarter. And we sing and dance, we have a great time. And I invite you to come. We're having ours on Friday at 8:30. We have a lot of parents that come because it's part of our culture, it's what we do at the end of the quarter. We have posadas at Christmas time. We have grade level musicals. Every grade level has a musical, and it's a performance, it's a play, we have singing, dancing, the students have spoken parts, and we have solos. We have Maypole Mother's Day celebration, also Cinco de Mayo celebration. That's when the first graders, the focus is on first graders, they sing to the mothers, we bring in the mariachis, they have a maypole dance, kids say poems to their moms. Our parents really love that. We have a morning ceremony on Monday and Friday where we all stand out in at the patio, and we, of course, we pledge allegiance, we sing happy birthday to all the birthdays within that week. We have student of the week, we have awesome deeds, and then we all dance. We do the electric slide, the hustle, the Cupid shuffle. We do line dances, and we love it. We love it. We have our kinder and fifth grade transitions, but those are also musicals. The students perform. The kinders have done The Tortoise and the Hare and Jack and the Beanstalk. Then we have a student-teacher basketball game, and that is not students against teachers, but there are two teams of teachers and students mixed. We have a turkey bowl, and then we have the Nutcracker and Annie performance. The Nutcracker is every other year. This is our year for the Nutcracker, and it's fourth and fifth grade. They perform the Nutcracker at NHS. The students audition for the parts. They audition for the dancing parts. They audition for the speaking parts. And everyone else who's not in, doesn't have one of those parts is in the chorus, and they sing the music for the dancers. Now, we do all of this, but we don't take time from teaching, because Mr. Milner, who is an excellent, excellent music teacher, begins months before, and during specials time is when he teaches all of this. When they start practicing the dances, when they start rehearsing, it's after tutoring or during lunch. But we use very, very little class time for this. Annie, we have 1 year we have the Nutcracker. The next year we have Annie. And Dr. Varona, I don't know what I have in my mind here. And Mr. Morales have gone to see Annie. So has Mr. Zimmerman. They're really great. But Halloween, that's our big time. That's when we have a wonderful time. Everyone dresses up. Everyone, the teachers, everyone, they have themes. This is all done. We do not take class time for this, because we are in a school. Okay, and so what I have next is a little slideshow where I have pictures of the first day of school and pictures of last year's Halloween, because all of these scores were from last year's kids. So I have some of the things that we did last year, our sing-outs. You'll see. If you can't find me, I'm the one in the gorilla costume. Let's see. Nope. Put it in the wrong.
Challenger.
Thank you.
I have that picture of Mrs. Santa Cruz because she is NUSD Teacher of the Year. And since I've been at Challenger, we've had three NUSD Teachers of the Year because I have an excellent staff, and I tell them all the time, you guys make me look good, because that's the truth. Questions?
Thank you for the presentation. There is a real culture out there. You can see it and feel it. I've seen it and I've felt it, and it's still there. It's been there a long time. And congratulations for maintaining that and the hustle.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. I can go to weddings now.
You do have a happy school.
Great. I do. Yes. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Ms. Vasquez, thank you for reporting the gap. I'm quite not used to seeing that, and it's nice to see the difference, statistical difference between the ELL students and your regular students. Thank you for pointing out that gap, and I noticed that the gap is narrow in mathematics, which is real nice to see. Just, I have a question just so I have a better understanding. On your strategic goals for math in fifth grade, the AMO was 68%, and the score, the math score, was 28%, and your strategic goal was 81%. How did you come up with the...
Okay, what I did with the strategic goals was I wanted to make them attainable also. So I looked at where they were before. I looked at the AMOs, and in a lot of places, they had already surpassed the AMO or already reached it. So I added 3 percentage points. Does that make sense to you?
3 percentage points to what?
To what they had before.
Oh, the 78%.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay, because what throws everything off for me is this AMO at 68%.
Yeah, that's the AMO the state had for us, but they were 10 points above that already.
Okay. I'm just saying because there was a presentation that was made, and Mrs. Montiel made a good point to a question. I just want to make sure you're not grabbing too much with the common cores, because you're just working on the common cores, and if they start to put in that, when the testing comes in with a Common Core, I just want to make sure it's realistic for the students and
exactly,
the teachers.
Exactly. And this year we're testing on AIM still, not the Common Core yet. So we're trying to get a good mix.
But some of the grade levels will be with, I understand from reading the state newsletter, with the Common Core, and next year everybody will be on the Common Core. But I just wanted to see your response. I'm glad you have a balance between being a median score at NUSD of 146, which is a great growth from 131 to 146. Mm-hmm. I compliment your leadership on that, as well as the commitment from your instructional staff, your partnership. I've been to your activities. I think it's so important to have a BNA school, have a good statistical score as you did with 146, but not just a consistent emphasis on the students of test, 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 test.
Exactly.
Let the kids learn how to jump in a puddle of water. And I think you balance that out very well, especially getting your parents involved.
And the parents really appreciate the fact that they can come in and see their kids, and they know that we're practicing with the kids and we're having these performances for them, but they're not losing class time. They're not losing learning time. But as they learn these songs, as they learn the lines they have to say, it's helping them with reading. So we're real pleased. I'm very happy with the way the school is. I'm really thrilled with the culture. And when people come in, like we have substitutes that come into the school, they can feel the culture right away. And they tell us, call us back, because they can feel the culture in the school.
Mrs. Vasquez, this is your last hurrah.
This is it?
I'm looking forward to seeing the results next year and looking at your total points for your last year as an educational leader of that school. And I hope your benchmark will be our top score of 165. You can get your kids up there.
Well, hopefully. Hopefully. And now that you brought it up, I would like to thank the board and all of NUSD for 37 wonderful years. It's been an adventure. And I've enjoyed it, and I think I'm going to miss it. But I'm going to spend a lot of time with my granddaughter, and that's something I need to do.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Mrs. Vasquez, thank you.
Thank you.
Karma. Karma. I'm just going to tell you, karma. Karma will get you. And boy, does it ever. Good afternoon, President of the Board, Dr. Nash, board members, Mr. Zimmerman, Superintendent, all top-level administrators, all my colleagues and friends, and all of our audience members, community members out there. Thank you for this opportunity to present the AIMS data and our goals from Lincoln Elementary. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Lucina Romero. I am the very proud principal of Lincoln Elementary. This school has been serving students now for 91 years. We celebrated our 90th anniversary last year, and this year I am celebrating my 34th year at Nogales Unified School District, so it is quite an honor to be here tonight with you. I'd like to take a moment, if you will allow me, to have some very, very special audience members here to please stand up. I will not even try to name everyone because I will inevitably miss somebody because my brain is a little bit tired. So it'll show my age, and I'm not going to try. But I'd like to start with my students. I have wonderful, wonderful representation of our student body here. Students, would you please stand up? We have student council members, we have choir members, we have cross representation of all our grades here. Thank you, stay standing. We have here present many of our parents who are strong supporters of Lincoln. Our parents, would you please stand up? Wonderful parents. Some of these parents form our targeted quarterly instruction task force or our school improvement committee. We do have a community member here that is on our task force. Mr. Velasquez, would you please stand up? I don't know if Mr. Fuentes is here tonight, but now don't sit down. We have wonderful representation from our classified and our certificated staff. Would you please stand up? I applaud you and I thank you all for your continued support, your commitment, your willingness to embrace the changes that we have made at Lincoln. Thank you. I appreciate you all very much. Thank you, students. And thank you all for being here with us. You know, they say the greatest things come in little tiny packages, right? So stop giving me a hard time about being short, people. Oh, sure. Arizona Department of Education has designated Lincoln Elementary School as an A school for the second year in a row. This classification system rates schools from A through F based upon different criteria and points that are given. Now, we do have the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, which is the accountability system from the federal government, which has given us a label of a reward school, which means that we are a Title I school with high growth and closing the gap with the bottom quartile of our students. These charts provide you with information regarding the components of the composite scoring system. We received 71 points for passing the percent passing aims. We received 3 points as an ELL bonus, which means that we reclassified a high number of our English language learners. That percent can be seen down here. We reclassified 42% of our FAE students, who are our full academic year English language learner students. We tested 158 students, 66 of them were reclassified or they passed the state test, which assesses the English language proficiency, which is a ZELA. Here, you have the medium growth percentile of all of our students that were tested in grades 3 through 5. We received a 67.5% growth. For the bottom quartile students, the medium growth percentile was 70.75%. The total average of the growth was 69%. In this bottom box, on the left-hand side in blue, you have all the points which comprised the actual letter grade. We had 74 composite points given to us for the percent passing aims. We also were awarded 70 points for the growth that our students made. The total was 144 points, and we received a final letter grade of A. The percent tested FAE plus non-FAE means that we had the percent of students that were full academic year or started the school year with us and completed it. Non-FAE are those students who did not start the school year with us. This is the letter that was sent to Lincoln Elementary by the Superintendent of Public Instruction in August of 2012, naming Lincoln Elementary as a high performing reward school. We did meet the criteria that was set forth by the Department of Education, where we met our annual measurable objectives, as well as learning a letter grade of A, and we had above average achievement and growth amongst our bottom quartile students. We received this letter from the Deputy Associate Superintendent, Nancy Conitzer, outlining the application process for Title I Distinguished Schools Recognition Program. We are a reward school, and we have applied for this program or recognition. The goal that has been set by our team of classified and certificated staff members, and with input from the principal, is that by the end of the 2012-2013 school year, our school label from the Arizona Department of Education will be an A. This will be based upon the results of the spring 2013 AIMS assessment results. Before I continue with the data information and the charts, I would like to congratulate our students for their strong commitment and dedication to learning, our staff members for their perseverance and tenacity, and our stakeholders for believing in us, even though what you will see is not something we are content with or satisfied with. We are still proud of the students and their efforts, and we know we will continue working harder, and we will do whatever it takes in order for our scores to continue to grow. This data shows Lincoln Grade 3 AIMS 5-year comparison. At the very top, I have the data that is disaggregated. We have the number of students that were tested in third grade. 18 of those students were classified as English language learners. 38 out of 44 students qualified for free or reduced lunch. We had 6 students that were classified as needing additional assistance in the resource room, were classified as special education students. You can see that we did have a dip in reading. 66% of our students met or exceeded the standards on AIMS for reading. In math, 61% of the students passed math third grade. We did have a dip of 20 points. I will go back after I'm done with these slides to explain what has happened there. If you look at the top little box here, we set our goals. The goals were set in accordance to those goals set by the school board, which called for an increase of 5% in each of the academic areas by grade. So our goal that was set for third grade reading is 71% of our students will meet or exceed in reading. For math, it'll be 66% of our students will meet or exceed. Grade 4, 5-year comparison, AIMS. We have the N, the number of students. 59 students were tested. 29 out of 59 were considered English language learners. 55 out of 59 students qualified for free and reduced lunch. 6 of the students were classified as resource students or special education students. Here, we had 66% of our fourth graders passing the reading component of AIMS. We had 68% of our students passing math. Both areas showed a dip in the scores. Now keep in mind that these are, we're not comparing cohort of students. We are comparing different years of students. They are not the same students that we are comparing. Although we did do longitudinal study to compare these fourth graders and how they did the previous year in third grade so that we knew where they stood and what their needs were. We did disaggregate the data going down, drilling down to the individual student level so that we could see what it is that they needed for additional assistance. The goals that were set by the teams for fourth grade, 71% of the students will meet or exceed in reading in fourth grade, keeping in mind that we're going with the board established goal of 5% increase. For math, it'll be 73% of the students will meet or exceed in math. Fifth grade, 5-year comparison. And we start with the N. 63 students were tested. 18 of the students were classified as English language learners. These students had not yet passed the state assessment of Azella. 55 of the students qualified for free and reduced lunch, or free and reduced. And 6 of the students were classified as resource students or special education students. In this grade level, we did have a slight increase of 3%. So 78% of our students passed reading. In writing, we saw a dip. We went to 51% of our students who passed the writing exam. In math, 56% of the students passed the math component of AIMS. So we go back and we look and we say, what happened? Why did our student achievement decrease? Again, we know that they're not the same group of students, but that's not an excuse. So we looked at the goals again, set forth by the teams. For reading, we did not go with the established board goal of 5% because we looked at it as a SMART goal. And we know that we had to set an attainable goal, realistic goal that our students could strive for. We know that the AIMS will be more rigorous. We are not testing on Common Core this year. But the rigor has increased. We know it will be more difficult. We know what we're looking at, and we know that we need to prepare better for these tests. In writing, we are aiming for a percentage of 56 to pass the writing components. Keep in mind that writing has two different components. One, 60% of the writing assessment is writing on a prompt that is scored using a rubric. 40% is multiple choice based on grammar. And the students must select and look at the answers and then decide which is the best answers. They must extrapolate this information looking at what they have in front of them. So our focus will be on literacy development with an emphasis on grammar. For math, 61% of our students will pass, and that is keeping in mind with the board goals of 5%. Again, these are the goals, just on a different chart. The goals were selected by the staff, both certificated and classified along with the input and the recommendations from the principal. This information has been presented to all our parents, our guardians, our community stakeholders at our open house Title I meeting in August of 2012. This presentation has also been made to our task force, our school improvement committee. This chart, which I apologize to the board, I did not include in the original presentation that I sent, but I have included those data charts for you. I inadvertently left this out, but this shows the gaps between the students, the mainstream students or the proficient students, and our English language learners by grade level, by content area. We wanted to look at the gap. What is the gap? Significant difference between the two groups of students. At each grade level, I had two teachers, except for fifth grade, that had three teachers. The way the state mandates that we separate our students out or place our students in classrooms is by their designated language proficiency based upon a Zella. So if the students are proficient, they are to be together in one class called mainstream. If they have not passed a Zella, even if it's by 1 point, then they must be placed in the English language development program, which is the mandated for our program from the state. We looked at the gaps, and we can see in reading third grade the difference. 96% of those 26 mainstream students passed reading AIMS. Only 22% of our English language learners passed the reading component. The gap, 74%. Our task, how are we going to close that gap? We need to get them a lot closer. Fourth grade, mainstream, 30 students were in the mainstream class. 97% of them passed the exam. The ELL group, there were 29, 34% passed. The gap, 63%. Fifth grade, mainstream, 45 students, 93% passed. 18 students, 39% passed. Gap, 54%. Math, we did the same thing, 88% passed. The mainstream group, the ELL group, 22% passed. Gap, 66%. Fourth grade mainstream, 90% of the students passed. ELL group, 41% passed. Gap, 49%. Fifth grade math mainstream group, 69% passed. ELL group, 22% passed. 47% was the gap. Writing, only fifth grade takes the writing exam. 67% of the mainstream group passed. 11% of the ELL group passed. Gap, 56%. So you say, okay, so what are you going to do about it? We know what we have to do. This is a composite of the three grade levels altogether. So you can see again, 101 students were mainstream, 95% passed. ELL group, third through fifth, 65 students, 32% passed, the gap 63%. For math, 80% of the mainstream students passed, 31% of our ELL students passed. The gap, 49%. Writing, same thing. What is causing the gap? As we disaggregated our data, literally tore it apart, looking at all the components of what we have been teaching, what were we missing? Previous years, we've been able to achieve the AMOs or surpass in some areas, but what are we not doing? What did we miss last year? So when I look at this data and we went back and looked at the number of students, we did find that in third grade last school year, we did have 11 students that were new to our school, some from out of state, some from within the state from other cities, some transfers, very few transfers from within our district, but the majority of the students came from Mexico. And I really like what Mrs. Vasquez said about using DIBELS in Spanish to assess the students, but we are finding that the majority of these new students coming in third through fifth are not coming in with a strong literacy base in their first language. So we're backtracking. We have to go back to the foundational level of early childhood. reading literacy skills, and that is starting on phonemic awareness and phonics with these students. These are our newcomers. We must backtrack and ensure that they are acquiring the academic English vocabulary. We must look at the rigor and the relevance, because they can spit out words. They can regurgitate what you teach them, but they cannot apply it. The relevancy was missing there. So we're going back and ensuring that what we are teaching these children is relevant and they can link it. Teachers are now linking more than ever to prior knowledge. What is it that they can anchor to so that they comprehend what they are actually learning? Because in reading, as math and writing and Azella, it's about not just speaking the English, not even just reading it, but do they really comprehend those academic vocabulary concepts? That is going to be our focus. Develop that vocabulary for the students. Focus on literacy priority. Also, in math, the math is not computational per se. It's not 90% multiplication, division, subtraction, plugging in formulas like algebra. It is not. It is reading and reading comprehension. So we are going to focus on specific math vocabulary. And when the student reads and you have a child that is already 12 years old, coming into fifth grade for the first time into an American school, and you give them what we're teaching them, and they're staring at you like, what are you talking about? We must be able to get them to the point when they're reading a math word problem that they can extrapolate that vital critical information, transform it into an equation, and then apply everything that they have been taught, and then do the computation. Plus, then remember, we must teach them test-taking skills, because multiple choice. It's not really about showing all their work. It's about, can they select the correct answer, given that they have A, B, C, D, three have distractors. One is correct. We're encompassing everything together so that we assure the students that they will learn. So what are we going to close? How are you going to close that gap? If you look at this, this is how we're going to do it. Is it changing the way we do business? Yes. Absolutely. Is it going to be hard? Yes, it is. Our staff members and our parents are exhausted, and I know that. They are exhausted, they're really tired, but they don't give up. And that's what I really appreciate about my staff, my parents, my students. They don't give up. We had to look at everything, look at the dip in the scores for all content areas. We don't want excuses. I made staffing adjustments. I looked at the data that no one helped me with. I looked at it first. As soon as Mrs. Canto, our school improvement director, sent me the scores, I took it apart, I looked at it. I looked at staff strengths. And then I made the adjustments. Teachers knew before they left in May that they were going to be moved. So, and I called upon them to step it up, look at what we had to do, and help me make those changes. These are all a list, and I'm not going to read all of this because I think you've had time to read this, but for the purpose of our community members, we don't have acceptable losses. We do targeted improvement. We review all our data for the last 5 years. We look at all data points, and we know that we must make all our goals in order to maintain our label. We have to reteach. We have to provide intervention to meet the specific needs of our students. But most of all, high expectations, accountability, and no excuses. We all have to have high expectations. We are very much accountable for what we're doing, and I take the strongest accountability on my shoulders, because what happens there relates to what I'm doing with our staff and our students and our community members. All the instruction that is implemented is based upon scientific research. The delivery of the instruction was on the Arizona State Standards, is now on the Common Core State Standards. We use the results, which are critical to making instructional decisions to drive our instruction. And this, we must provide extended learning opportunities for our students. We do have a commitment to teach literacy, math, writing, and reading regardless of what's happening during the day, irregardless of schedules, early releases, pictures, in-services, assemblies, and special events. We have to do it. We have a large variety of members on our school improvement team. The principal is highly visible on the campus, in the classrooms. I do conduct my walkthroughs. I do provide relevant feedback to the staff, not just the teachers, the paraprofessionals as well, because they are a very important component of our intervention teams. We strive to increase our parental engagement, and we have parents that are there every day, all day long, whether in the classroom or helping us with other areas of our school. We continue to supplement instruction by our interventions, which continue to be targeted, specific, basic, explicit, direct, and utilizing effective teaching strategies. Again, rigor and relevance. We must continue to do that. Staff assesses their own instruction. They assess the learning of the students. They use the data to select those appropriate instructional strategies. And we must remember that we're striving to close those gaps. The small group instruction, the grouping is flexible, but they're based on real-time data. We are increasing the student engagement in every area of the campus. The teacher is the most important deliverer of instruction. That teacher, as Mrs. Vasquez explained earlier, must present the information to the students as a whole class, then assess, reteach, reassess, and continue on until that child has got it. We also provide support for our staff members via the literacy coach, the reading specialist, and the principal. We have common planning time, and the standards and performance objectives are posted in each classroom and referenced. The bottom one is very important because the instructors seek to help the students develop those mathematical concepts, perseverance, construction of viable arguments, and attention to precision. This is very important because we have students talking more. Communication skills, verbal skills are critical for the students to look at the mathematics that we are teaching. Some of these words, if I tell you, what is an Euler or a vertex or a vertice? Go, sure, come and teach me. We're working together as a team. The teachers focus on writing their lesson plans, and they're all focused on what we're doing with our school improvement plans, our goals, the results of all our assessments, our priority objectives that are listed after we administer Galileo. I have worked with every teaching staff member, and each one has completed a professional growth plan, which they have provided a SMART goal for me, which we will work on for this school year. Our classrooms utilize the sheltered English immersion model, which is the state model for English language support for our students who have not mastered past the Azella. These are all the instructional techniques and strategies that we're using. One very important one is concentration on vocabulary and scaffolding, chunking down the information so that students understand this information in small bits. And we are providing supplementary support sessions for students during daily 40 to 45 minutes of intervention by grade level. So all the students receive additional support on a daily basis. We do continue to follow the TQI process. We teach, assess, reteach, reassess, and then we provide individualized support. Our teachers present on a yearly basis to our parents, and we call them parent power night sessions, and they focus on skills. How to help the parents so that they can learn some strategies on helping their students, their children at home. We focus on skills that are being targeted by the grade level, and then of course common planning time for all the teachers on a weekly basis. Additional support for students. We have many recognition programs as well as after school activities where students can participate. Recognition for being Students of the Month, the Challenge or Gifted program, for students who are at or above grade level, because even though we provide additional support for those that are at risk, we don't want to forget that we must focus on the students who are already there. We cannot let them backslide, so we have to keep on challenging them with higher order thinking skills. If they qualify, they will participate in the challenge program in grades 3 through 5. Pensaremos is actually a higher order thinking skill program for our students in grades 1 through 2, preparing them for those higher order thinking skills. We participate in contests, county fair, we have choir, junior Olympics, band, art club, dance team, student council, before, during lunch, after school tutoring. We have wonderful community relationship with our Boys and Girls Club, who is our next door neighbor. The University of Arizona Cooperative Extension Office provides a program, walk to school or bike to school. And we are actually having this program on Wednesday morning. You're welcome to join us if you'd like to walk with our students or bike to school at 7 o'clock in the morning. We start at two starting points, one at the skate park and one by the bowling alley. I was gonna say Perkins and Frederick. That's the corner we start off at. And we do invite the parents to join us. Huge turnout for these events. We also coordinate with Nogales Police Department, and they do provide a patrol car to help us with traffic control there. We participate in the fruit and vegetable program to promote healthy eating. University of Arizona has a Mix It Up Nutrition Health program. The DARE program, which is a program for fifth graders, that is a drug resistance program, partnering with Nogales Police Department. We have Caught Being Good, which partners with our character counts and pillars of character to recognize students who have been showing good pillars of character. Talent show, everyone is invited to participate in the talent show. So we have from the itty bitty ones to the oldest ones. And we do partner with the University of Arizona again to put on a bicycle rodeo. And for this one, we partner with Rio Rico Fire Department, who come and teach the students about bike safety. This is the composition of our school improvement plan called the TQI Task Force. For this year, we have one representative from each grade level, as well as a representative from the different areas around our school, different curricular areas, as well as our classified staff and parents, paraprofessionals, two community members, and the principal. So you can see that's a pretty large group, but we do meet once a quarter to discuss the data, and they provide input for us as well. We have excellent, excellent stakeholder support, strong parental engagement. We have literacy as a priority. We're using our data to drive instruction. And at Lincoln, we are a family. Very large family, but we work together as a team to ensure that our goals are met, but that the needs of the children are met, not just the academic, but the social, the emotional, and the physical needs of our children. This school has been serving students for 91 years. Beautiful campus. And we thank you because we have been provided with many, many updates to our school, and we continue to receive assistance from our district administration in helping our school improve in all areas. We are all in this together. That is our motto. We are all in this together. No one ever says, that's not my job, that's not my child, that's not my student, that's not my grade level. So at this time, I'd like to thank you, the school board, Superintendent Zimmerman, Assistant Superintendent Parra, and all our district administrators for your support so that we can continue doing what Lincoln Lions do best, which is?
Dream, believe, learn, and achieve.
They dream, they believe it, they learn it, and they achieve it. And I am so proud of them. Stop it. Stop. I am so proud of them. Thank you. Any questions?
Well, Doctor, I know 14 years on the school board, I know about what tired means. I know also that you are aware that success is a journey, not a destination. I'm very confident that you've done and succeeded at that school before, and I have no doubt that you will again. I'm not so concerned about the dip, as long as I know that you all are committed to recognizing it, dealing with it, and improving it. So I wish you luck with that, and wish you more linking at Lincoln.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Morales.
Can you explain the big dips in the math?
Yes. In third grade, the dip, like I said before, the test was more rigorous. It did change, and this changed statewide. And it wasn't the same group of students. And in that grade level, we did have many of the students of the 11, remember, out of 44, 11 is one-fourth of those students that did not have the same literacy skills in order to pass the test. So the reason they dipped, they did not have enough of the vocabulary to pass the test. We did have students that came in way late in the school year, so they were not privy to the instruction that the teachers had provided starting from day one. Some of those students actually came the week of testing, maybe not in that particular grade level. So it was lack of an opportunity to have learned the skills that the teachers had taught. And there was a change in the assessment.
Okay. Thank you.
Dr. Varona?
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Dr. Romero, first of all, congratulations on applying and getting the school out there for the National Title I Distinguished Schools.
Thank you.
I hope you keep us abreast of that, and I'm glad you're taking the time to demonstrate to others the good things that are happening on your campus. Also, your 71% medium growth percentile of the bottom 25%, and considering your bottom 25%, how well you did there, and the gap that you have between the mainstream and the ELL still shows a good emphasis that you have on that. Those aren't the forgotten students for you.
No.
Your instructional strategies of that 25% and taking them out at a 71% percentile is a great emphasis that you've put on those kids. And I don't want those kids to ever be the forgotten ones just because they're at the bottom 25%. And I congratulate you and your staff for that great emphasis.
Thank you.
With that. Also, Dr. Romero, you alluded to a longitudinal study by cohorts. Can you tell me, in reference to the dips that you had by the cohorts, can you tell me on that longitudinal study that you did, what did you derive that was statistically significant data that has you having a change in instructional methodology?
When we looked at the data comparing the fourth graders of this past year to the third graders of the previous year, we looked at what they had achieved, looked at the difference between the English language learner cohort group and the mainstream or proficient group. Then we started looking at what had the teachers done that made that group of mainstream students so successful. So that then we had a meeting with the teachers so that they could speak to each other and discuss what they had done to help the students. And the strategies that we derived from these meetings were that the teachers had to talk to each other to begin with, more vertical and horizontal team discussions, and implementing more of the programs that would help the students actually accelerate on the acquisition of academic English vocabulary. But it was the fact that we were trying to go through the programs as they were written for us, but we needed to take a little rest, and look at what vocabulary they just weren't mastering. But this was derived by looking at the data, but also looking at the results of Azella, looking at Dibbles, looking at Galileo, but mainly by having the teachers talk to each other.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Dr. Romero, it's quite evident that you are research-based because the statistically significant data that you discovered is being spread around through the teachers. You're sharing it with the teachers so that they can incorporate and use the data into the classroom, which hopefully next year we'll see different scores for the cohort. And I compliment you for that kind of research and
thank
interpretation.
You.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Dr. Romero, thank you.
Thank you.
se ve la misma. La mesa se ve la misma.
¿Qué pasó? Mira, mira.
Is Barbara, are you leaving now?
Thanks, Annette.
You know, Miss Barbara.
Let's see. You got her good, I think.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, board. Mr. President, Mr. Superintendent, Mr. Zimmerman, and members of the audience, and my colleagues. I'm really glad to be here tonight. I am Claudia Weldon, the proud principal. I've been thinking about president. Proud principal of Mary Welty Elementary School. And before I start, I just wanted to make a comment. Last week, when we heard all the presentations from the schools, some with wonderful videos and pictures and some a little more basic, then all the ones that my colleagues have presented tonight. Truthfully, I hope y'all get the pride that's within our group, within every educator here in Nogales, the professionalism is just outstanding to me. You know, I'm a principal, I meet with different principals at meetings, but we don't get to see the nitty-gritty that the principals have presented, you know, to each of you. And the teachers that came last week, I've worked in many schools in Nogales, and probably last week I had worked with like 60% of the teachers that were in the room, and they're here, you know, because they love what they do. And I think I appreciate the board giving us a chance, even though it is extremely nerve-wracking, to present the details of our schools, because I learn a lot from every single one who comes before me. So I'm really impressed with all my colleagues here and everybody in the whole district. They're, the teachers and the students and the principals are amazing. But I hope I know how to work this well. We'll try it. Mary Welty Elementary School was also designated by the Arizona Department of Education as a high-performing Title I school. We earned our A grade, and we worked hard for it, and we're very proud of it. We did this by meeting our annual measurable objectives by the state, and we had above average achievement and growth among our bottom quartile students. In addition, we were awarded as a high progress school. Again, we had the A or B letter grade, above average achievement and growth among the bottom quartile, plus the above average growth for all students. I did not put together a slide that showed our points. I do have those with me, though, so I can go over those later. But we are extremely proud to have moved from a B school to an A school. Our student and staff demographics, we're one of the smallest schools, so our total population is 323 students. 50% of our students are English language learners, and 91% free and reduced lunch students. And what last year and this year, about 50% of our students do ride the bus and 50% are pickup. I know Ms. Suarez had asked about certification. Last year we had 13 classroom teachers, one long-term sub in kinder. She returned to us this year and we're waiting for her test results. And then of course, like the other schools, we have a certified music teacher, special ed teacher, one reading coach, and one reading specialist. And now I'm going to be going over the five-year data overview, our strategic goals, and our strategies and interventions to achieve these. Beginning with third grade, you can see that our teachers have done a great job for the past 2 years. Let me see. My first year as principal at Welty is the yellow column. So in third grade, we'd been averaging about 75, 74% in reading. And I made some adjustments in staffing, and the two teachers work amazingly well together. They work off of each other's strengths, and they were able to raise our reading scores to 92 and then 90 last year. And in math, again, they just exceeded all of our expectations. They jumped from 66% to 81% to 90%. Last year, our goal for ourselves was that 85% of our students would meet or exceed in the area of reading. The state's AMO was 80%. We exceeded our own goal of 85% and reached 90. This year, the state AMO is 82%, and even though we've reached 90 in the past, as all of my colleagues have mentioned, we're working with a different group of students, and I can explain a little bit more later, but we are focusing and intent on getting a minimum of 82%. We're not satisfied with that, but we do feel that may be an realistic expectation for this year of our third grade students for meeting or exceeding in the area of reading. Our third grade math goals, and again, let me see, I'll just go back. Again, there's the math. It went from 66 to 81 to 90. Our goals for ourselves were 80%. The AMO was 77. We exceeded this goal of 80% and reached 90%. For this year, the AMO is 76%, and we believe that we're going to get at least 76% of the third grade students meeting or exceeding in the area of math. One of the things, as one of the principals, or maybe several have mentioned, is we do have an influx this year of new students from Mexico, and so we're working hard in our ELD program to get them up to the success that we have had in the past, but we can't realistically guarantee that they will be 90% again, but we're trying. We'll never give up. Our fourth grade, my first year was 81%. It dipped down in 74% in reading, then to 77%. Same thing in math, 73, went down to 66, is back up to 67. The test, as everyone has said before me, was changed in 2011, so that affected a lot of our fourth graders. As we hear about everywhere, there's a fourth grade slump across the state, maybe across the nation, whether it's partly developmental, partly academic, the objectives and the students we have, to all of that combined, but we are coming back up in fourth grade. It was it hit us really hard when we went down, and we hated that, so we're working toward moving it up. Our goal last year was that 80% of the fourth grade students would meet or exceed in reading. The AMO for the state was 78%. We reached 77%, and this compares to 78% who passed overall in the entire Nogales School District, so we were close to that. And even the state average, even though they set the AMO at 78% in reading, the average fourth grader in reading in the state made 75%, so we did exceed the state average. Same thing for our goals this year. The AMO is 81%, and as you can see, that's a huge jump even from the 78%. 3% is pretty high jump, but we're going to go for the state goal of 81%. And what we found, as similar to the other principals, I sit down, I meet with the grade level teachers, we meet as a team, we all go over the data. We're really lucky at Welty because we are small, so we sit and can discuss students individually. We know their backgrounds, we know who's hurting at home, we know where they're struggling and maybe reading and not math, so we can talk about individual students all the time, and we do this. And for fourth grade, let me see, well, that's what we did, and some of our kids also were newly arrived, and several were considered for CSTs for special ed. So we've got a mix coming in that grade. But it sort of averages out with the rest of the state. Our fourth grade math goals, our goal was 75% in math. We reached only 67% of our students meeting and or exceeding in fourth grade math. This was a little below the district-wide average of 71%, and just a little bit above the 66% the state of the average statewide fourth grader. So again, even the AMO of the state, they set it for 75%. Only 66% of the students met it statewide. And so they have adjusted the AMO this year to 74%. And so even though we're 67% last year, our goal is 74%. As we broke down the information and studied our individual students and our individual grade levels, because we are so small, one student at Welty equals 4% growth. So we had one student, I believe, that was 2 points away from passing, and that would have brought us up to 71% in the math, and I think 80% in the reading. So every student does count everywhere, but especially in the small schools. Fifth grade reading, writing, and math. Our teachers did very well last year. We went from 77 to 78 to 81% in reading. And we were especially proud of this because we had the highest number of resource students we had in several years in one grouping. But everyone worked together, and these students brought their scores up, and everyone else did too. So reading did just exceed what we were hoping for. Our writing scores, similar to writing school scores everywhere, really dipped. The test changed, adding in 40% of it being multiple choice and being affected by grammar and the knowledge of grammar, punctuation, word choice. That's difficult for our English language learners, and when we have 50% population, that does affect them. Our math sort of stayed the same, a little dip, but we went from 52 to 66 to 64. For our reading, our goals were 80% of the fifth grade students would meet or exceed in reading. The AMO was 77.2%. We surpassed these goals and reached 81%. For this year, the AMO is 84%, and that's what we're going for. We were at 80%. We're going to go for we had 81%, and we're going for the 84. Fifth grade writing, 65% of the fifth grade students is what we had hoped would pass in the area of writing. We only met 55% of our fifth graders, and from what I understand, I believe 56% of the state fifth graders passed. So we're right at the state level, but it's definitely not acceptable. The 65% this year, there's no AMO, but we definitely want at least 65% of our fifth grade students meeting or exceeding in the, oh, I put reading, but I meant writing, as measured by the spring aims. And one of the things that I think will help us out is this week we're doing the Common Core testing, the Galileo Common Core testing, for the first time ever. This has never been done. We've done regular Galileo that are tied to our standards, but this particular Galileo 3 days of testing is our first pretest for the Common Core. And the information we're getting from these evaluations and these assessments show us the higher level of challenge that's being required by the Common Core and shows us another way we need to adapt our teaching to meet this. You know, like all of us, especially I think Ms. Holguin has really been researching the Common Core. And it's, as one principal, you know, put it, in a nationwide magazine. You know, it's a work in progress. We're learning by doing. It's all coming on us pretty fast, and it's really amazing. We're trying to get all of our kids nationwide ready for this century and for the years to come. And it's really difficult. We're having to have a whole change of mindset, and that's what we're talking about. And so it's not just the reading, writing, and math. It's a whole new way of teaching that teachers are having to come up with to meet the challenge. And they're working on it, but it really is a work in progress. And like Lucina said, I think that's why everybody's tired. Our minds are just, you know, spinning with this new information. But it's going to do nothing but make better citizens. I mean, this is the future, and we're ready for it. Our fifth grade math, 72% of our kids met or exceeded in the area of math, was our goal. We only reached 64%, and this compared to the 67% at the district level and 63% of the state's fifth graders. So even though the state set their AMO as 72%, only 63% of the state's fifth graders met that goal. So we're thrilled to be 1% above the state. The state kept their AMO at 72% this year. They didn't change it. That's a huge, you know, it's 9 percentage points above what the average state fifth grader did last year. But we're at 64, and we're going to go for it. We're doing everything again to adjust our teaching, adjust our instruction. We're meeting together constantly. And as all the other principals said, too, you cannot work in a school anymore if you don't have data-driven instruction. You're just out of touch with the times if you don't realize that the data. And we're not just focusing on the test anymore. There's that goal of where our kids need to be for the future. The strategies are, again, very similar to everyone else. Daily and weekly administrative walkthroughs, observations, discussions. Teachers meet at grade level. We meet individually. The reading coach and reading specialist are continually helping each and every one of us with all this new information. The new professional development at the district level, focused on the new Common Core standards, has really been outstanding. We're just starting this. This year, led by Angel, again, the elementary principals, and I'm sure the middle school and high school, we're being brought back together as a team for the first time in many years. We're all friends, we're all colleagues, but this new Common Core implementation has pushed us to a level of having to learn ourselves that principals have been meeting with Angel at different times, and then she arranged it and the principals worked on it. So on an early release day, every single teacher at each grade level met at a different school. And it was a 2 to 3 hour training on Common Core and discussion. What works? What doesn't work? What do you think about this? And this is, I'd say, a bold move forward. And it certainly has helped me and my teachers. I know they all came back feeling that they're not so alone out there, that there's someone who understands what they're going through in these changes. We, too, started out 9 years ago as a Reading First program at Welty. That has been the core of the success for reading there, I believe. It's an uninterrupted 60-minute reading block with additional daily small group reading interventions. So every morning the teachers do their reading program. They're the core, they're the main instructor, and then we have at least 6 to 7 instructors, all our parapros, our library technician, our computer tech, the music teacher. Everybody takes a group of students from each grade level and does a 30-minute intervention at that child's reading level. And everyone uses a specific curriculum that the team meets on. When they see what these kids need, everything's based on our Dibbles reading assessment. And we do that weekly, biweekly, monthly, the progress monitoring. But once we've got those kids' scores down, then the students who are most in need, there won't be more than 4 to 5 students with that teacher and the highly certified teacher. By the time we get to, you know, the higher level students, we found enrichment activities for them and put them in that. They also, the kids who can move ahead and go ahead, they're at their level. And the kids who need support, they're at their level. And it's just been a wonderful program and made a big difference. I had mentioned last year that we could see we were struggling in math and we wanted to do similar things with math interventions as we did reading. And so we had started out with only we cut back to, I believe, 3 days a week reading interventions and 2 days a week math. And as we were going along, we just realized it wasn't enough. And we had heard about Vail School District up in Tucson and a lot of the success they had had. And so we came back, and this year, several of our teachers, I believe, went and observed there. And they came back, and so what we've implemented this year is in the afternoon, we're taking another 30 minutes after their math instruction, their regular math instruction. We've divided the students into 3 levels the way Vail does it. There's remedial level, support level, and enrichment level. And the 2 strongest teachers, again, we work on teacher strengths. The 2 strongest teachers will take the students most in need. And the other teacher, who's also an expert, takes the other students and moves them forward at an enrichment level. And we're very pleased with the results so far, and we're doing that, like I said, 4 days a week. We've adjusted our schedule. A lot of our social studies and science is being integrated through our reading programs. We too are similar to the other schools. We found that what our students are really lacking is that academic vocabulary in math and reading. So our teachers are constantly working on that. They come in with the social skills, with the social vocabulary, some basic classroom vocabulary. Our high level of English language learners are lacking that somewhat, but the academic vocabulary is just really amazing. Again, I keep referring to my peers. As Dr. Romero said, I had never heard of vertex edge graphs ever in my life. You know, I've got a master's. It doesn't seem to matter. That's now taught in 4th and 5th grade. Everything is moved down. And so trying to teach these things with a lack of vocabulary and a lack of understanding of knowledge of the English really is hard for the kids. So we've intensified our use of sheltered English instruction strategies to use with all kids. So all kids who are at risk and are struggling, those strategies, mostly like preview, review, lots of discussion, those help everyone. And we found that works a lot for our kids. Finally, the data-driven lesson planning. Our lesson planning, we've really adjusted. I've been going back and forth with the teachers about their lesson plans are very detailed, and they follow the calendar that was set up by all the teachers at the grade levels over the summer, and then it has to reflect the Common Core standards so that anyone who comes in would be able to look at that and not just know that it's ARL 3.6.2, it's that we're working on character, main character in language today, in literacy. And so that's really helped because it gets the teachers focused. Even though they know it, I think, internally, backwards and forwards, if you're able to teach someone else something about it and they're teaching me through their lesson plans, then it becomes a lot more clear to them as they teach the students. We've increased the mandatory after-school tutoring in math, reading, and English language development for students who aren't yet meeting or exceeding on the AIMS. We are very fortunate to have 2 full computer labs, and so those are packed 3 days a week with a teacher in them focusing on the Study Island, the KidBiz,
we have Education City, and all the kids are intensively working on those, and then I announce scores each week, every 2 weeks. I'll say the top readers this week and got the most points, and the kids really love that. We have weekly, monthly academic meetings, grade level leaders, literacy leaders, principal parent meetings, and staff development meetings. Just like all the other schools, I could, you know, they've messed up my PowerPoint because they presented everything I wanted to say. I just brought a couple of slides about some of the things we did for the families. One of the things that we brought in last year was from the Arizona Economic Council Foundation. They call it a Family Financial Literacy Night. And they came in and they did, they separated the students from the parents, and they taught the students about what do you want, what do you need. They talked to the parents about saving money and looking at a budget. And then they brought everybody back together to put, well, here's a picture of the parents as they were listening and the kids were in the back. If you can see the chain, that chain against the wall, at the end of it, we had this chain that was going across the entire cafeteria with students, something they had made with their parents, talking about this is what we want, this is what we need, could we afford it, what could we do to get to that, if we wanted a new car, if we just wanted new clothes, whatever. It was very practical. The parents really enjoyed it. And, of course, they gave free pizza. We all loved that, too. One of the things we were surprised I don't have a slide on it, but last week I held my Title I principal parent meeting, where it's the annual meeting required by Title I, where I presented the PowerPoint. I talked to our parents about all of our goals, all of our exact scores, what we're doing, what our strategies were. And for the first time ever, we had 155 parents show up. I mean, we kept adding chairs and adding chairs and adding chairs. And so we have parents who may not be educated themselves. Many are, but a lot aren't. But they want their kids to succeed. And so they're there to support us, and they're just wonderful. Let me see. One thing we do with kinders, we have lots of activities, but one of them was the roving chef, and I just thought they were cute. The high school kids from the culinary arts program come and actually cook with the kids. The kids have to participate. It's completely hands-on, and you can see the little kinders looking up at these great big high school kids, and just they're in awe. And here's what, but they did the orange chicken, and it was just amazing. This is a fantastic program. We're going to be doing it again soon. And then at the very end, when we finally done all we can do, we do have an annual field day where we just let loose. And the kids, yeah. And actually, this only shows part of it, but there were little swimming pools all over that entire area where you couldn't see over here. And then a crawl-through type of thing over here on the left, and a sandbox. And the kids get hot dogs or hamburgers. And then I brought in the fire truck. And everybody, they just sprayed and sprayed the entire school. The kids, this was like the first shot where they just put out the water, and the entire the kinder through first graders stayed upstairs in the little area where it was a little more controlled, and then the bigger kids came down here. And I think Dr. Verona mentioned something about jumping into the puddle or something a while ago. Well, we literally jumped into the puddle. And then we had tug of war. You can see the mud. I did not let them back into the school after this, no. I offered to wash down any child who wanted to be washed down. And that's well. Okay, questions?
Hector? Thank you for your presentation.
Oh, thank you.
I have no questions.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Mrs. Weldon, you didn't present it, but can you tell me a little bit about your medium growth score for your bottom 25% on the...
Yeah. The overall our overall percent passing was 80%, so we got the 80 points on that. The median growth percentile for all of our students was 57.5, and the bottom quartile 65%. So we had an overall growth of 62%. We did get the 3 points for the ELL reclassification. So our total was 145 points, and you had to have 140 to be an A. So we were 5 points above. But overall, the bottom quartile moved up 65% growth.
Good. Also, Mrs. Weldon, at the county fair, you had a poster there, a very meaningful poster on 9/11. It was very meaningful to me. What I don't remember the teacher, I think it was Mrs. Bloss and somebody else, but that poster, I couldn't believe that those young kids could be so insightful and recognize the value of patriotism and not forgetting what happened and remembering all the fallen ones. I just want you to know that of all the posters that I had at the county fair, I thought that was so meaningful, and I'm glad they got the best of shows, because it was very good.
Thank you. As you can see, I really appreciate that. Everything back here, our teachers did in just within a couple of weeks, and again, because of the Common Core, we don't have art class anymore, so everything they do is like a hands-on activity, talking about, you know, the stained glass, you know, talking about geometry, the 9/11, they tie that into the social studies and history. I had to be out 2 days of that, and so we hadn't had a really big build-up to that. So that was something the teachers did themselves, and that other one's the 9/11 poster. And because I was having the parent meeting, I didn't send that one over here that was best of show, but I will be sending it later so you can all see that. It is very impressive, and I believe it was the first grade teachers, that Miss Bloss and Miss Benavides. And what's cute, one of the things that's missing, like these posters, Miss Coppola's class, and I believe Miss Olivas's class too, these are called paper buddies, or book buddies. The books are missing. I did send them over, but what on the wall, each child drew an outline, had somebody draw an outline of themselves. That's them thinking about themselves, but then they have to go interview a friend and write a book about it and give their whole history of their friend. And so the books were attached in like a 3D mode. Miss Coppola had them, you know, folded up the arms, and it looked like they were kidding. So everything we're doing is incorporated into the art, but the 9/11 ones were very meaningful to us too. Thank you.
Also, on your cohorts on the third and fourth grade in reading and math, they did take a dip, but I'm glad that you're saying that basically your instructional strategies is data-driven, and hopefully that'll be corrected next year.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Mrs. Weldon, you weren't here at our last regular meeting in which you submitted your retirement letter, so I just wanted to tell you very much on my behalf and everything that how much we appreciate your instructional leadership going into a school at Welty, which has a high socioeconomic factor there, and it's quite evident that you've been working hard on that, and your work has not gone unrecognized whatsoever. Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Mrs. Weldon, thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Are you going to stand up there?
I have a stool on this.
You have a stool. She's got a broken foot, so she's going to be sitting there.
All right, good evening, everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, members of the board, Mr. President, Superintendent Zimmerman, audience members, community members watching this on television. I am Michelle Olguin. This is my 7th year as principal at Robert M. Bracker Elementary School. Thank you for letting me be here to present all this information about the best students in the world. I know everyone gets up here and says that, but in my case, it really is true. And I tell the students that every time we get together, I tell the staff and I tell the parents, because they are very intent and intense on getting to where we need to be so our students are successful so they can shine. Going last makes my presentation very quick because there's very few things that are different that I need to present outside of my own specific data, because we have wonderful, wonderful principals here, and we're all together listening to what everyone has said, looking at what I'm going to present. You're going to see that we're all in it together. We're sharing ideas. I saw that we were writing down ideas from each other. So many of the things will be a repeat, so I'll do my best to be as concise as possible. We are an A school 2 years in a row. We are very proud of that accomplishment. The way that we got here, we focus on the teaching the standards and what the students need. Teamwork, persistence, being smart, using best practices, using data, and using each other. And as far as the persistence, I would just like to point out that we don't give up on our students, our team members, or ourselves. We just keep going. We also are a school who earned the Title I recognition of high performing, and you can see the criteria there. In addition to receiving the high performing award, we also earned a high progress award. And as a staff and students and parents, we're all very proud of this growth that we're getting from our population as a whole, but also from our bottom quartile students. And as a result of this recognition, as you have already heard this evening, we were invited to participate in the National Title I Distinguished Schools Recognition Program. And the purpose of this program, straight from the letter that we received from ADE, is that it is a national recognition program to identify exceptional Title I schools that will represent Arizona. And we also did apply, and I want to wish the best of luck to all of our NUSD schools that applied. I think that based on hearing everything, that we should have at least one school who participates in that, whichever school it is. Our demographic for last year, our enrollment was 288. Our attendance was 95%. Our free and reduced percent, 78. Our English language learner percent was 35 at the time of the testing. Obviously, this was before our reclassification based on the end of the year Azella testing. And I have it broken down by grade level for your information. That's pretty typical to how we have it year to year. The only difference this year is because the Azella changed at the kindergarten level, the percentage is drastically different. And this year, as of right now, I only have 26% of my kinders who are classified as ELs. That's at the beginning of this year. Our A designation was a result of the composite score. We had a school-wide rate of 78% passing plus the three ELL bonus points for 81 points. Our growth score was 63, and that's a total of 144. That's what got us our A. This is the chart of the percent passing that is straight from the Arizona Department of Education. I do want to point out that these data are based on our full academic year students, so depending on which group you're looking at, some of the data will be a little bit different. But here you can see overall, we had 78% of our students passing reading and math. Our growth table, this table has the data for all of our students, and again, you can see overall, we had growth points of 59, and the growth is based on the students compared to similar students across the state. So it's not that we grew 59%, but it's that our median percentile ranking is at the 59th compared to all of the other students in the state. Here is a table of our bottom quartile growth, and we had a total of 64. And I would just like to point out that this is not the bottom 25% of third grade, of fourth grade, of fifth grade. It's the bottom 25% of the whole school. So I didn't provide the data to indicate that, but Depending on the level of the group, we might have more students in third grade in the bottom quartile than in fourth grade. And in fact, that was the case, that it was different in reading and math. And in, if I recall correctly, in reading we had more bottom quartile, bottom 25% students in fifth grade, and in math it was our fourth grade students. And that's just how it was for the last year. So here are the graphs of the past 5 years. I highlighted in purple our previous years. Our third grade is very strong, having wonderful results. I do just want to point out that this data includes all of our students, not just our full academic year students. So you'll notice there is a discrepancy between the ADE data and this data on this graph. So our third grade is very strong. Our fourth grade in reading, very strong, making pretty steady for a while, making a little bit of a gain last year. Math in fourth and fifth, you'll see, we're plugging right along there. It still is our lower performing areas. In fifth grade, unfortunately, we did have a dip last year. There were some staffing concerns. I addressed those staffing concerns. We don't expect to see those anymore. When we saw that our progress monitoring data on our students based on DIBELS, based on Galileo, we saw that they were not performing where we wanted to as a school. We provided extra support for that group. It didn't get us the results that we wanted, but we're confident with some of the changes that we've made that this will not happen anymore. I also included our English language learner information, our data for you. And very proud to say this is one of our strong areas. We had 104 ELs last year who were assessed. Kinder through fifth grade, the percent that was reclassified as proficient was 61%. And students making progress, which means that they moved up at least one proficiency level on the Azella. Azella has 5 different proficiency levels. So these students might not have made it to proficient, but at least their English proficiency is increasing, was 80%. And at the end of the year, the students that we had for last school year, they're only 14% still classified as ELs. Now, the number that I, what we have, of course, at the beginning of the year includes all of the new students, so we're not at 14%, but this is how we ended up at the end of last year. Here is our achievement gap information, and I did not break it down by third, fourth, and fifth. I put all of those scores together for you. But you can see that we had 24 English language learners in third through fifth who took the AIMS last school year. And of those, half of them passed, half of them failed, unfortunately. So the reading gap was large, 42%, and unfortunately in the reading, the gap increased from last school year. Again, there were some issues, some staffing issues that we took care of. So we expect much better results for this coming school year. Our math gap is almost at the same percent as it was last year. I do want to just point out that, and it has been, you know, said many times, yeah, the group of EL students is very hard to classify because year to year they can be a very different group of students. It could be a group of students where the majority of them come straight with no English skills, or it can be a group of students who come and have been in your school school for many years. And that impacts it. So even though they're all classified as EL, they all can be very different in what in where their skill levels are and what their needs are. Most of the ELs who passed were students who had been at our school consistently since kindergarten, and most of the students who didn't pass were new to our school. So when we're looking at setting goals, I shared this with you last year, I just would like to share it with you again. These are all the things that we take into consideration. The group demographics, again, we're being a small school, the demographics of the group make a big impact. Being so small, one student is worth 2 or 3 percentage points. It makes a big difference. Mobility really impacts our school. For example, 12 out of the 23 EL students were new to our school. Open enrollment students make an impact. We're very happy to have our doors open to as many students as we can have to come into Bracker. I do have conversation with many of the parents, not all. I'm certainly not categorizing every student who walks in the door this way, but many of the students who come in the upper grade, the parents tell me that they may have been struggling at the school that they were going to, and they transfer them to Nogales because we have a good reputation of strong academics. And you can tell the difference. The students are not used to the level of work that they're doing, and so they have a learning curve where they really need to catch up to where we are. And that speaks well, of course, of Bracker, but of Nogales as a whole. We also look at state AMOs. This year, the Common Core standards and assessment changes need to be taken into consideration. So these were our goals for last year. I have the goal, I have how we actually did, and whether or not we met the goal. And as I stated before, fourth and fifth grade math is a struggle area. I'll address some strategies that we're working on to help those, but it has been, fourth and fifth grade math is where it really starts to get difficult. All of the academic language, everything that everyone has said, I don't think that I need to repeat something that you've heard nine other times. And in our fifth grade, we had some issues that we addressed so that I will never see 51% passing ever again. So our goal, obviously, we want to maintain that A label for a third year, which means we need to match and improve last year's percent passing. We need to have more growth in fifth grade, because if you go back to the growth charts, it was relatively low. But we also need to continue our focus on growth for all students. And doing this will help us maintain our A. So the goals that we set here, these are goals that are realistic, and they are based on all of the considerations that I just previously listed, in addition to looking at the specific students that are sitting in our school. Our third grade goal may look low, but we looked at that specific groups of students' data that we have to make a realistic goal for what it is that will make our students successful. So for strategies, I don't have very many strategies that aren't listed here, and after seeing all the other nine presentations, there are so many other things that we could add here, because we really do work together and we take ideas from each other all of the time. We're saying, oh, how do you do this, and let's get it on here. But these are the key strategies that I identified along with my grade level curriculum team. Our growth is our focus. So for our bottom quartile of third, fourth, and fifth grade, we've tweaked our intervention program in reading and math to make sure that those students are getting really focused intervention. We have tried more of the shotgun approach in the past, where we knew that the students needed everything. So in trying to provide everything, things got watered down. So we have targeted to their most basic, what is their gap, to get them where they need to be, and that is that is the intervention instruction that is being provided to those specific students. All of the students in all of the grade levels are being taught from the Common Core standards, so the rigor is there, as you have heard many times. We do reteach to mastery. We also teach integrating the skills in multiple contexts. That's just a reality. We have a very finite amount of time. We have so many things that we need to teach that if we didn't integrate, we would never be able to get there. In the Common Core, there's an increased amount of time required with informational text, and that is something that we have seen over and over about the functional text, expository text. Now in the Common Core, it's called informational text and varied writing tasks. So this is something that we are working on. One of the principals already spoke about how all of the elementary teachers got together by grade level and worked on improving our writing instruction. One of the things that I'd like to just point out here is that we know that by using more informational texts, our students are going to do better. Our science aims, in 2011, we only had 48% of the students passing. our fourth grade students increasing the amount of time using the science materials and increasing science, we went up to 64% passing. So we know that was just in one little grade level, and we know that by doing that across all the grades, we're going to have a very, very powerful impact on our results. We also have after-school tutoring. We have groups that are for our EL. We call them newcomers. These are students who come with a very low proficiency in English. To start the year, we also targeted all the students who didn't pass AIMS last year in fourth and fifth grade so that we can get them going in the right direction so that they will pass in this school year. We have to focus on vocabulary, especially in math. Data-driven instruction, you've heard that before. Now it's just a part of the way that we do things. It's not anything new. We are always looking at the data. We're always looking at other forms of data. We're sharing data with the parents, something that we started last year and we had great success is having our parent trainings during a breakfast. We had tried them at night and we weren't getting the attendance that we really wanted. So we heard this idea from another school. We took it and ran with it. And last year, we had between 80 and 90% of our parents coming to parent breakfast, depending on the grade level, which is incredible compared to the attendance that we would get in the past. And what the teachers do is, stated at all of the other schools, is they tell the parents what the expectations are for the grade levels. Here's how you can help them. Here are some materials. And go home and do it. And we're working together as a team. Parent conferences, we also have a very high percentage rate of attendance. We have to have at least 95% of our parents attending conferences, which I think really speaks well of the efforts that our staff makes and the efforts that our parents make to work together to help our students. Professional development obviously is key. Here's those Common Core standards again. We have to keep studying them and reading them and reading them over again and looking at them in 7 different ways, 8 different ways, 9 different ways, many different ways to really have a deep understanding of it. I am very proud of my staff. I mentioned earlier that they are very intense. 7 teachers, and I have 12 classrooms. 7 teachers are attending the Southern Arizona Mathematics Institute to improve their math content knowledge. And that was something that Mr. Bender mentioned at the high school presentation, is the teacher content and knowledge in math is critical. And these 7 teachers all volunteered. I did not ask one person if they wanted to go. All I did was pass the email on that was forwarded to me, and that day 7 people signed up to go to this training. To me, that speaks of the intensity and the dedication that they have to do this, because this training, if you're not aware of it, it started in the summer. It was 2 weeks in the summer. They're going approximately every month for 2 full days. It's a lot of information. It's just really wonderful. Feedback, as you heard from everyone. I also want to highlight the support from the district meetings. This collaboration amongst the principals is key. Everyone does wonderful things, but we don't always have the time to share them, and that's when we have the time to share them and figure out what it is that we're going to do. We also have academic meetings. I make sure that the structure is there, that I'm flexible enough that I can change the schedule if needed. We change the schedule because our third grade group of students needs an extra round of intervention. So third graders have a reading intervention time and a math intervention time. That is something that we're always up for at Bracker, is we have to try things and make them work. If they don't work, we tweak them to get them there. And I mean, you can certainly see all of the other different things that we do as part of our structure to getting these changes in place. We have a strong emphasis on character education. I take the students at least once a quarter, and we have grade level meetings, and we talk about anti-bullying programs. We talk about what students can do. We talk about what it is and how we can make Bracker an anti-bullying school. And just the repetition and the belief that I have deep in my heart that we have the best students and the staff and the parents in the world. We really do. Everyone works so hard to get there. Here is just a small list of extra activities that we do. We participate in a lot of the other activities that were brought up. We do have the Character Counts Recognition Program. Dolphin of the Month is a Student of the Month program. We have these green slips, which are like the catch me being good. When students are following the rules, when they're showing great character, they get a, it's called a green slip. We have random prizes. That is such a wonderful motivational tool. We have chorus. I didn't put up there. We also have chess, and I'd like to thank our chess sponsor, who is a teacher at Desert Shatters, Oscar Villaseñor. He saw that we needed this. He asked. He's on board so that we can provide these things. All of these other things that we participate in make the school a fun place for the kids to be, in addition to working really hard. And in closing, I just would like to say, you know, we talk about numbers, data, 42%, 52%, 62%, but this is really, oh no. Is it going to start all by itself? Oh, he's going to. This is why we're here.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place can be brighter than tomorrow. And if you really try, you'll find there's no need to cry. And this place, you feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there if you care enough for the living. Make a little space, make a better place. Heal the world, make it a better place.
So those 300 students plus the other 5,500 students in Nogales are why we come here. We don't just come here to have great numbers, which is wonderful, but we come here to make an impact on their future. So with that, I'd like to thank you and open up to any questions that you might have.
Thank you once again for presentation. I have no questions, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I am glad that all the principals are supporting each other. Mm-hmm. That's very important.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's very wonderful.
Mr. Chairman, Superintendent Zimmerman, Mrs. Olguin, I was really glad to hear you talk about your flexibility and that you're not rigid when people come up with suggestions to say, oh, we can't do that this year. We got to wait until next year to do it. So I'm glad because that melts down into success in the classroom for the teachers and the students. And that was a nice administrative technique that I was really glad to hear. On your
Thank
math
you.
Training, I compliment you for that, but you bring out a highlight of the effectiveness of our College of Education at the universities and in teacher training, which I've always had a great inherent problem with. But I'm glad that they're going out and getting this kind of training on their own beyond that scope. And with that, you just need some work on the cohorts as they're moving from the third to the fourth to the fifth. Besides that, thank you for a nice presentation, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Superintendent Zimmerman, thank you.
Item three, any final comments, discussion by the board, Hector? Any final comments you'd like to make?
I guess,
meeting still in session.
Yeah, I guess, Mr. Chair, my only comment would be, you know, it is it's very useful and informative for us as a board to be able to listen to our principals, and certainly the level of skill and knowledge that they show is very obvious, and their teamwork is very obvious. And all I can ever hope is that I, as a board member, can provide a service of just allowing them to do their work, trying to provide a fairness in the environment in which they work, and a commitment from the board to support them. That's all I can do as a board member. You do the rest. You all do the rest. And I'm certainly not here to tell you how to do it or what to do, because you're the professionals. You know what to do. You know how to do it. And it's fun to watch it because it's working. We're an A district, and We're on the border. Forget the demographics. Forget the location. You make it happen. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Frank?
I am very, very glad that we have such great principals, and I think you love kids, and I think if you're doing what you love, you got the best in the world. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I thought that what I enjoyed here is having to see that the partnerships that are available here, the administrators who I saw in an attentive mode for all the other presentations. And I compliment those administrators who stayed here to listen to every one of the presentations and how you paid attention to everybody's presentation. You can tell the teamwork that's involved here. It's just not words. Everybody was responding to each presentation, supporting and offering suggestions. I also want to thank the Teachers Association for being here all the time and showing your support for the administrators here and the students itself, because you're a partner. The county school superintendent is a partner. The administrators at the district who I saw here all the time, being here, offering support, is extremely relevant. I hope all of you take advantage of the Family Resource Center. That is something that is so important to the final achievement when the students graduate, especially with a Common Core. You understand that our socioeconomics and those families and parents need help from 0 to 5th grade. There's going to be 2 administrative positions, and I noticed that the staff always was saying that we can't do things like we used to do before. We have to be data-driven. I just hope that the administration takes into account with these 2 new positions, 2 administrative positions that are leaving us, that we go ahead and get somebody into those positions in January so that there's a transition with the teachers and the students, so that we don't just say they're going to show up on July the 1st. They need to know now to understand the culture of the school. It might take Mrs. Soto some juggling, which I know she can do with the finances, but we cannot do business like we've always done before. We've got to get those administrators selected, search them out, and put them into that school in January so that there's a good transition. So over the summer, every teacher, every student, every parent knows exactly what's going to happen. We are a community that has a high population of Hispanics and kind of economically deprived. But overall, I was really happy to see our scores. They're good scores. The cohorts, we need to spend a little bit more time. I really want to say that we went from a range of 124 points to 165 points. I hope there's more emphasis, not on the letter grade. The letter grade is something that was surfaced by the state legislature to tell parents how a school is doing. But I sure hope that you as administrators pay more attention to the growth and how close you can get to 200 points. The closer you get to 200 points, you narrow the gap for Hispanic students and you narrow the gap for socioeconomic students also, which is basically what we're in right now. So I'm not so concerned about the letter grades. I'm concerned about that score that you get at the end of the year, the beginning of the year. That's what's going to tell what you're doing to narrow it. And also, I was glad to see the Superintendent Hoopenthal, his final results for Hispanic students. Look at those results at the state and compare that to NUSD. We're right above those Hispanic results. And that says a lot for this district, a lot of it. I'm looking forward to the new teacher evaluations that are going to be implemented next year. I think if you correlate that to what's happening here, we're going to see a lot of good things. There's a lot of good things that are happening. And I don't want to sidestep the issue, but there's good things happening because we got strong leadership from the superintendent. We got a superintendent who's committed, who has a focus on academic achievement that's complemented with data-driven results. And I don't want to let that go because his team has done well. From the deputy superintendent to the curriculum director, I see partnerships here. I don't see individuals. I see a great nexus of success that's coming. But I just want to say that I'm glad to see, more than anybody else, I've worked through more superintendents than anybody else. And I'm glad to see the leadership, the keen focus that there is on instruction, data-driven results linked to accountability. And I'm here to support that, because I want, especially our students, when they leave here, that when they graduate as 12th graders, every one of our students can go directly to a university and is qualified to go to straight to a university. Whether that person wants to go or not, that's that person's decision. It's our responsibility to make sure that that person is academically ready and astute to meet that challenge. And Superintendent Zimmerman, I just want you to know, with these presentations, I thought they were very insightful. I thought that the community needed to understand this. I hope there's more emphasis placed on these range of scores, and that two of our schools, one school scored at 165, the other one at 157, that is recognized at the state level for the best practices and the leadership, the methodology, the pedagogy, that's happening, and we need to reward that. And we also need those Title I schools, with the partnership with Title I grants with Mrs. Scott, applying for these things. That's so important, because that we get millions of dollars, and I know, without having to snoop around to see how you're spending money, that you're spending that accurately and appropriately just by those rewards that we're getting. And I think so far, Superintendent Zimmerman has done a wonderful job to lead this district in the right direction. My opinion is we are headed in the right direction with the partnership that he has built at every school site, with teacher involvement, student involvement, parent involvement, and we have good principals. I just hope that Superintendent Zimmerman will put in place these replacement administrators at the school in January, so that we have a smooth continuity and there's still that keen focus that's going on. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
I just have one comment. I kind of forgot I said this last year. I wanted to see what happens. You always see the third, fourth, and fifth grade, but you never, of what they did from the year before, but you never see the continuum of what happens to those third grade students, then to the fourth grade, then to the fifth grade. I hope that next year they could put that in, so we could really see what happens to these kids. Do they improve when they go to the fourth grade? Do they not improve when they go to the fifth grade? And to see how they're doing. Other than that, I enjoy the presentations. I didn't see last week, but I heard they were good. Steve, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I just have a couple comments. First of all, thank you for your comments. But let's talk about just two things I think is really important. Number one is the goals that the governing board has set. Remember, you have two of the five that are focused on student achievement, which is what we're in the business for. The other ones are partnerships, which is really important. A fourth one is that we are going to have 100% of our teachers be highly qualified. Because at the end of the day, it really does come down to who you have in the classroom. After 25 years, I can tell you, I've seen good teachers, fantastic teachers, and I've seen some bad teachers who were fish out of water and had no reason for being in that classroom. And I can tell you, over at least the last 4 years, almost 5 years that I've been here, that the principals have made a concerted effort to make sure that they have the best in the classroom. And that it isn't that we have a desire to eliminate maybe teachers that have potential, but here's the thing. We have some who probably weren't really trained well in their undergraduate studies. It's been a pet peeve of mine my entire career too, because I think that there are some programs that don't prepare teachers for what they're going to get when they get into the classroom. We just had, when we had the new teacher orientation, I made that mention. I made that even with our substitute orientation that we had the other day. And we want to give them the professional growth and development here, because maybe they didn't get it where they were at, whatever undergraduate program they were in. So I think really just hiring the best, and if they become a fish out of water and they just don't get any better, I think it's our responsibility to move those folks down the road to maybe a position that they would be better served in. And I think that is what has happened in American public school education, is that I think that there are some people who aren't cut out to be teachers. And I can tell you, I worked with them as a teacher. I've seen some superstars, and I've seen some that weren't cut out to be teachers. And the fifth goal that we have is the issue of making sure that we maintain a safe and secure an environment. The reason why I bring these goals up and remind everybody is because the comments that you have been making have all been focused on them, and you're the ones that set those goals. We just make sure that we are implementing the strategies to make sure that it happens. And I am proud of the commitment from our principals. I enjoy the fact that when I go to those schools, they are welcoming parents, because sometimes maybe they feel that they're not welcomed. And it is nice to see them there, and that is a welcoming place. And I see that at every single school. And the other one, I'm just going to make a very quick comment, is that we said this when we announced our grades, that we had 6 A's and 4 B's. And even the schools with the A's, we all know by looking at the AIMS data, though we are doing well, we're not where we want to be. And just because we have an A school doesn't mean that they can't win the Super Bowl the next year. It'll become harder and harder as the expectations become greater. And it is just really nice to see, though, that the focus, I want to remind you, and Lisa, I think, stepped out of the room, but last year when she scored also the highest, four last year, she walked out of here and she said, boy, what am I going to do next year? I don't know if we can maintain this. And that's what she said, point blank. And I looked at her and said, well, if anybody can, it's you. And then she brought it up to 165. And just because you are achieving and getting to a higher level doesn't mean that you cannot keep moving forward. We have some schools that were hovering around what I would call a B plus, A minus, so they were on the border. So there is room for growth. But at the end of the day, I think what the governing board and the community want to see is, show me the scores and are we improving? That is, at the end of the day, are we getting better? If we were a 5-5 football team, we want to be at least 9-1 next year. Hopefully 10-0, but just showing the growth. And I think that's the one thing that I think I keep telling the administrators, is that we don't have to hit the home run every single time, but you have to at least try for the fence and at least do our very best to make sure that we are working hard every single year. When I go to the schools, I can see it. I can see the principals. I can see them looking at data and making decisions that are best for that population of students. And I'm lucky. I'm lucky because I do have a very good leadership team at the district office, and I have a very good administrative team, and it makes my job so much easier. So I just want to say that.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Zimmerman, I second that.
I bet you do. Okay, that was Marcy.
Meeting adjourned.
Hector, second.